Philosophy. Question. Enlightenment. Deep conversation. Spirituality. This is the spiritual download.
And I explore environmentalism, relationships, politics, my own life, health, healing, through the lens of spirituality, which has really been a focus that's exploded into awareness for me, starting last year and then deepening ever since. Today, Kyle and I are going to be talking about spirituality, health, and healing. And this is a topic that both of us have wanted to engage in this venue for some time now, and finally we've gotten around to doing it. For me, this is a topic I started to focus on seriously, I would say in April. About a month into the pandemic, I began to analyze my stories about health and healing and what constitutes health and where it comes from. And I think as this year has continued and as more and more issues have become magnified for humanity, we are entering this inquiry with different domains or different kinds of health. So racial justice begs questions of what health means. Climate change asks whether our relationship with the environment is healthy and what it would look like if it was. We can have healthy and unhealthy relationships with social media. And I think people's psyches are really being affected by how they use these platforms. So we'll be touching on these kinds of health through the shared lens of spirituality. So maybe just from what I've said so far in establishing the topic, something comes up for you, Kyle, something that you want to start with.
Yeah, absolutely. So when I first heard of this topic, thinking about health, I think a lot of times in the West, so like in America or Europe, when we think about health, we think of purely, I mean, for hundreds of years, it was just about the physical body, which I believe is one aspect of life, one aspect of consciousness, is the physical body. I believe the mind is also an extremely important key, like layer of the onion of life. And finally, you know, since maybe the year 2000, 2010, people are finally considering about the mental health, and that's kind of being spread across schools and companies. And finally, people are being open to think that, oh, maybe I should go see a counselor or something. And we agree that we're not crazy. You know, 30 years ago, people would have thought I'm crazy for going to see a therapist. So that's just body mind, right? And now we have the added layer of the spiritual aspects of life, such as the soul. Okay, so now we believe in the trio, the body, mind, soul trio. And so people now are starting to seek, should I start meditation? Should I, for mental and soul health, not just the body. The body, you know, people say, let's do yoga, asanas, and yoga, hatha yoga. And so that helps body, mind, and soul. And so we seek healers and other experts who can help us on all three realms. And I also want to add another realm here, which is your heart center. So I believe that even deeper than one's soul, which is still an individualized aspect of your experience of consciousness, is that heart center, which I believe one can trust at an extremely, extremely deep level. And that actually, it is what you are ultimately. It's what exists, whether or not you're alive or dead, dreaming, not dreaming, deep sleep, very awake, near death experience, out of body experience. I think it is actually the heart consciousness that we need to really start to be thinking about and talking about even beyond the body, the mind, and the soul, which I'm not saying those three things are bad. I'm saying that I think this is a these are four elements of ourselves that we can start to see are inextricably linked with one another, and that if you improve one, you're inherently improving all four. But if you're stressed in one, you're hurting all four. Although I believe that the more like the heart and the soul ultimately can't be hurt, because the heart and the soul are kind of your rock. It is your the foundation of who you are. And that's why I think that's what you can trust most, is your soul and your heart. And having less trust as to what is your mind telling you and what is your body telling you. I think that those are much more tied to our animal nature, that again, maybe not trust it 100%, because this often leads to suffering, attachment to either whether you're successful or miserable. Still, those are short-term things that a human could be attached to, basically the human self, which is, I think, inherently it's inherently an imperfect thing, which I don't think it's bad. I just think imperfection, again, leads to ignorance and suffering ultimately. So I think when you live a life that is much more centered from the heart and the soul, so kind of flipping that on its head and say, so my heart, my soul is the center of myself, and really secondarily, I'm a mind, and definitely not this body. This body can change, this body can die, this body can experience suffering. This body can be an attractive person, but not even getting attached to those good things, you know, that would lead to always being in one's heart and always living from one's soul. So that's kind of what I've been thinking about for a week or two here as we're mentally preparing for the satsang, the talk here. So Jackson, what do you have in reaction to all that blabbering I have?
I wouldn't say it was blabbering. a lot came up though, for sure. We were kind of joking before we started talking, like Kyle and I, as much as we are in touch with our spirituality, I think it's fair to say we're both very mind-based people, and we like to categorize things and we like to decipher the world in that way. I was just saying we are both Enneagram type fives, which is the observer, the investigator. So we like to kind of parse the world in this way and come up with systems for how to understand reality. I want to just present like a trajectory of how the relationship among these different sectors of ourselves has worked for me. I think as the paragon in our society, the type of person that we are told it is good to become, it is very rooted in the mind. And it's very much about having a vision for things that you want to achieve and then executing that vision in linear fashion. So I would say the whole time I was in school, you know, primary, middle, high school, and through college, I was being reared as a mind that was disconnected from my body, from my environment, from my community, so that I could achieve in this individualistic way. And for me, what ultimately happened is that it became exposed that living in that way produced suffering for myself and others. Like, it was immediately perceptible. I was sad. I was lonely in my body. I was angry. All of these negative emotional states that I kept reproducing through my actions. And that led me to seek out therapy. In this kind of juncture, many people will begin going to yoga. They will seek out spiritual teachers. They might break up from a relationship and seek out a new relationship. But they might take up a new skill or hobby, but there's an effort to rediscover the parts of ourselves that the unitary path of the mind leaves behind. And so for me, that means encountering or re-encountering the body and the heart. Once we really situate ourselves in our body and start getting to know our heart, I think it naturally transitions to an awareness of spirit. So a very clear example of this is if you do yoga and you're really taking the alignment seriously, you'll begin to feel the energy flowing through your body in the pose with the breath. And that energy transcends you. It's a somatic sensation that there is something beyond you coursing through your body. And once you have felt that, you really can't forget or deny it. And so the question becomes, what is this greater awareness or energy that is surging through my body, which is this ephemeral experience? And so then we can begin to operate on all the levels you're talking about: health of the mind, health of the body, health of the heart, health of the spirit. So I really think that for me, and I think for many other people in this society, there's kind of that linear sequence where we start to discover these things. The other thing I wanted to say in response to what you were talking about, because you were talking about how it's becoming more acceptable to go to therapy and now to seek out spiritual teachers and to traffic in that kind of discourse. I think in the time when it was not acceptable, so you and I have talked about this before, if you go back to the 1950s, if you said, I meditate, I do yoga, you would be thrown in an asylum. You know,
that would be crazy, man. What are you trying to find, enlightenment or something?
Right. Or happiness, God forbid. It was so...
God forbid you get happy.
Right. That would be the most dangerous type of person.
Freedom. We don't believe in freedom.
Right. Well, we think we do. But just that part of what is happening now is that our society as a whole is becoming more healthy through recognizing that these other domains of life are important. So I just wanted to give voice to that transition as well that we're undergoing.
Absolutely. I definitely think that we're becoming healthier and healthier. I think when we focus much more on ourselves and loving ourselves, I think we're often taught that we need to be better. We need to be perfect. I think especially as a high school teacher, I see this, especially young girls in high school are pressured to be perfect. They're pressured to constantly be busy and adding things onto their resume. You need to go to Ivy League college. And they're taught, like, if you don't go to a top college, like, your life is over. And I'm gonna laugh about it because it's ridiculous. But I'm not laughing at probably the stress that they feel about that, right? I mean, and if you think about it, it just adds to so much bodily stress. When you're mentally stressed, you hold it here in your body, you hold it in your hands, you hold it in your gut, you hold it in your face. And personally, I've been starting a Qigong practice, which is gong means basically, I think it means like practice, and Qi is like what Jackson was referring to, is that like that light, that consciousness that we feel going through the different channels in our body. If you've played sports, you feel this. Just going for a run, you feel that energy start to bubble up and enter into your lungs, enter into your legs, enter into your hands. And there are actually practices out there. I would say hatha yoga, you know, most people call it yoga, is probably the best one. Tai chi, running, music, dance. There's literally a million things out there that can start to help you move the blood, the oxygen, the chi through the channels in your body, and you just naturally begin to feel that self-esteem rise up. So my question is, how can we start to make these practices much more quote-unquote normal in our society when our society is changing so fast? I see two paths. I see that we could choose to follow more fear, which leads to, I need to add A, B, and C onto my resume. I need to go to Ivy League college. I need to make $100,000 a year. If I don't, I will be miserable. So that leads to, but what if you don't? What if you go and follow your dream? What if you do that? Do we have the courage to go follow our dream with all of the potential dangers that could happen, right? We could end up broke. We could lose our health. But why do we focus on the negatives? Like when we want to follow our dream, why do we automatically go to the negatives? What if we say we have positive affirmations? I will follow my dream. I will be happy. I will make $100,000 a year. You know, these are things that, and you look at yourself in the mirror and you begin to believe it. And when your body, mind, spirit, and heart are all together and they're in tune, these things may, I'm not saying they will, they may manifest actually, the positive things in life may manifest when you're living in that reality, right? I believe reality is consciousness. So if your consciousness is focused on positivity, these are the things that we manifest in our body mind world as well.
I have a, based on that, and we're shifting topics kind of rapidly now, but that's fine. I have a question about what you think of the ways in which our society and world are transforming. So you're talking about this agenda of I need to go to a, you know, top tier college, I need to make this amount of money, I need to have this career. These I think of as the program, the cultural program that we're fed for what success means. And by the way, this has its own buildup and consequences. So if it's not right for you, if you're not in integrity going to law school and becoming a lawyer, your body will reject it. And ultimately, you will come to a crisis point and be forced to adapt or suffer. It may be impossible to continue. And I think that point intersects with so many of the other things we were talking about. For instance, the rage we're seeing around race relations in this country that was created through suppression and gaslighting for centuries. So it's a necessary consequence of the dynamic that will then inculcate a shift. But what I was wondering, so I'm thinking about this with respect to the crisis that universities are in right now, and I'm thinking about the fires that are raging on the West Coast and the pandemic, how life for humanity seems to be becoming less stable, less reliable in certain ways. I'm wondering if you truly recommend taking this attitude of manifestation, I'm going to just manifest the life that I want, or if it would instead be wiser to shift to a different set of values. I feel some doubt that there will even be that many remunerative jobs in the future that we're coming to. And I think we may need to take care of one another in more simple ways than that. So I wonder what you think of these ideas.
Yeah, I completely agree. I see the economy shifting from, right now the economy is focused on transaction as the medium is money. And I think in the future, the medium is gonna be like more like energy or basically caring. Right now people are motivated to make money largely for me, just me and my family, and my family. And that's the American way. That's the European way. I think there's change going on in Europe. I think what's going to happen is cultures from all around the world, if you've traveled to third world countries, you see that actually the economy is not solely based on money. That's not the main, money is not the main thing. It's actually a relationship. And I think if we start to combine this with the striving that we have in America, I don't think it's a bad thing to be an individual striver. Actually, I teach a course called AVID. The acronym is Advancement via Individual Determination. So actually, yeah.
So I'm laughing because it sounds like It sounds like a program that will be uploaded to Neo's brain in the Matrix.
Avid. Let's get Avid.
Continue.
So I don't think getting avidized is too bad. Like focusing on yourself and loving yourself, like I said, is super important. That's actually lacking in, like, for example, we lived in Ecuador. And in Ecuador, the values are, you know, family and love and fun, which I think is amazing. I think we need more of that here in the United States. But then if we got to add that love to everybody and ourselves. So loving ourselves is number one, loving our family, loving our friends, but then loving every culture, every human that's alive today, even because I also teach history. So even seeing in history that, you know, I am so deeply connected with the humans who lived before me. They are my ancestors. They were the brave ones who carved the path for humanity to be where we are today. Why do we have the beautiful things that we have today is because of them. So appreciating them and seeing that you are an ancestor for the humans who come after us, right? So in Native American spirituality, the idea is seven generations in the past, seven generations in the future. And that's what you are. You aren't just this individualized aspect of body, mind. You are that soul, heart that is connected to the seven generations before and seven generations after. And then seeing that as all the humans alive today, and eventually I think animals, plants, and even other life and consciousness beyond just Earth as well. But that's getting into a whole nother realm. But what are your reactions to that?
Well, that is and it isn't getting into a whole different realm for me, because, you know, I wanted to talk about social and ecological issues too as kinds of health. And I was actually thinking earlier and as you were talking just now, there's a perspective from which these issues are emerging because we are ready to face them. So it's not a new phenomenon that Black people in this country are suffering and crying out for white people's help. That's been happening for a long time. But to me, there seems to be a laser focus on it in this moment, which means not all, but some white people are actually seeing and actually wanting to change that condition. And I guess I want to suggest that there's a level of individual health one must reach before one is actually able to help someone else.
That's a great point. Can you explain that idea a little bit?
I just had this experience on a personal level that, so when I was suffering as much as, I have a very specific story actually that connects to this. I came to my therapist one time and I said, it seems like life is getting harder. All of the people in my office seem to be suffering so much. She goes, actually, what's happening is that you're suffering less. And so you're able to identify their suffering.
Wow.
You know, when my plight was at the same level or intensity as theirs, I perceived it to be normal. But once I started to release some of my emotional issues and become less burdened, I looked around and I was like, my God, these people are zombified, you know, and how can I be of service? And as we were talking about earlier, that's a natural question that arises too once I get into my body and my heart, because my heart is connected to the world and does want to help. But yeah, so I think this has been a very intense year with immense crises, and there's a perspective from which they are glaring because we are ready to actually do something about them. And I think this necessarily gets into what you were talking about earlier, because it begs the question of, can I be healthy if other entities with whom I am connected are in a state of ill health? So can I be content as a white person with material wealth if Black people and other people of color in this country are suffering, just to give one example, but this would extend to the environment too.
Right.
And to many other realms. So it's like, yeah, it's like a parallel would be, you know, you sprained your finger or something and you don't become aware of it until your body is actually ready to heal it. So wondering what you think of these ideas.
Yeah, absolutely. Because we live in an, I believe that we live in an ecosystem. So basically from a scientific point of view, I would say one of the most important things that I've studied in science is ecology that has helped me think about my spirituality. Because we are so, like, we can't even fathom it with our minds as to how connected we are with everybody and everything in our environment. And that as soon as you start to see, I'm not just a body, I'm not just a mind, I'm also like a spirit, and that there are actually realms of consciousness, such as energy, which you can be aware of. I can guarantee you can be aware of the energy field if you go and search for it, if you want to know. And then you start to see that realm, the law in that realm or plane of consciousness is oneness. More than the body mind world that we live in, which is based on duality, it's based on separateness and identity versus not. I am this, I'm not that. That person is in my group, that person is not in my group. That's based on building barriers and identifying and putting everything in boxes and labels, which is great for survival, for human survival. But if you're looking for a much more holistic approach to spirituality and happiness, it doesn't have to be about spirituality. If you just want to be happy, we can talk about that. Really, you want to find this balance. You live in this non-dual world of energy and consciousness and love, where we're all, you can see how we're connected, but you can also bring that down to this dual world of people and cars and planes and then emotions, right? You feel happy or you feel suffering. You bring that in and you say that, okay, well, the basis of all of this is oneness, but then it's paradoxically, I experience that in this dual world, right? Then you actually begin to become less selfish, because the selfishness is keeping you, basically, we're feeling that we're not connected with everyone else when we are selfish, and that you have to actually defend what's yours, defend your agenda. But when we live in that oneness, we begin to believe that we are the same, we are equal as everyone else, not just with the idea of human rights, which is in the mind, but also like the energetic field when you're in a conference room with everyone else. You begin to feel everyone's energy. And if your energy is full of suffering and craziness and addictions, that's going to negatively affect everyone else in that conference room. So what if you focus on yourself, heal yourself doing yoga and meditation, and then you go into the conference room and you're one of the ones that are holding space for everyone to be themselves, holding space for everyone to be loved and be love. And I've been starting to experience this actually as a teacher in high school, is that I think students are actually extremely excited to come back to school in a lot of ways. I've obviously, not wearing a mask maybe is that's kind of a negative thing for them, but having a teacher who is also invested in his or her health through yoga or meditation or walking, exercise, or anything like that, they're providing a space in the classroom for there to be healthy bodies, healthy minds, healthy spirits, healthy hearts. And right now in public school, you can't talk about the other two. You have to only talk, you can barely talk about like mental health. Otherwise people are like, whoa, right? We can talk about stretching and exercise, but for some reason we can't say like, hey, my soul is connected with your soul. My heart is in your heart. Your heart is in my heart. That's a whole nother way of talking, which I think in the future, I hope that public school is definitely more in that realm.
I want to suggest, though, and this is just honoring you as a teacher, to the degree that you are creating that sense of spaciousness in your classroom and students feel seen for who they are and that they can make those earnest explorations of their identities, to that degree, you are helping the system to shift, because your students will discover interests in things that they wouldn't have known if their energy had been suppressed or if they had been made to conform, and they will manifest a different amount of willingness to kind of bend to the system. They will seek out and do different things, and this system is ultimately composed of people, of teachers and students. And so, yeah, just think through your awareness, you're facilitating that shift.
Yeah, thank you, appreciate that. Definitely, so last year was my first year teaching. It was a lot of efforting and hard work to have that goal. But now this year it has a feeling of effortlessness because I'm in that flow state. From the meditation and the camping, being outdoors, having really healthy relationships for the first time in my life. I've been a very introverted person. So I've worked on myself for like 10 years, but now I'm bringing that into my relationships with my parents, my friends, and now my coworkers, my students. And then it's because it's not just about me, right? It's like I'm trying to be a part of the community that brings more chi, more love, more energy, more positivity, and less fear, less separateness, less suffering. Yeah.
Just based on that dynamic, I want to circle back to the relationship, or the relationship among, and the difference between heart and spirit. So it's the heart that really breeds our connection and our action in the world when we're in touch with it. The heart hurts when we perceive someone else's suffering, right? So when I see on the news that someone has lost their home in the fire, there's a part of me that viscerally feels sad. And that, I believe, is not my soul, but my heart. We may have differences in terms here. I think of soul as synonymous with spirit. So it is this energy that pervades all things. And we can have the individualistic lens of reincarnating in different vessels throughout time. But for me, once we really get what oneness means, and that it's all space and all time, that it's all inclusive, presuming that I'm an individual soul that's traveling from body to body just feels a little small-minded to me. Anyhow, it is my experience that spirit is what, with detachment, observes reality. So my heart is going to make me want to intervene and try to improve reality for the better. And my heart is going to be invested in positive health outcomes for all and in a healthier society. My spirit is what tells me that even if I fail in this quest, that it's okay. Because spirit knows that reality is perfect as it is, despite the suffering and because of the suffering. I forget what I was, I was just going to say, just going to add as a final thought in that regard, that paradoxically, this also makes us more courageous. I am more able to follow my heart. Actually, I would say I'm only able to follow my heart when I know that it's okay if I fail. So it kind of breeds commitment when we have this greater awareness. So I guess I'm curious if you have different understandings of those terms, heart, spirit, soul. This is how I experience them as they relate to health and action in the world.
Yeah, this is related to a question I was going to pose, is because I think if people might hear this conversation, like, Kyle and Jackson, they say things like, this could happen, this will happen, like it sounds very certain. But I think that if we only live in the mind and the body, we have this unhealthy version of skepticism, right? We say, oh, that sounds like it's unscientific, or that sounds like that goes against my belief of capitalism or something. But again, I see these as paradigms that are going to shift in the future. So if you look towards the future, where are we headed? I see society shifting big time in the near future. And I think there's going to be, like I said, there's going to be two paths, one of fear, one of happiness. I think that they will eventually, the fear pattern will shift. There'll be a consciousness shift to happiness. And that if you think about it, what if everyone in our society becomes healthier, becomes happier, becomes more in touch with their heart, what will the paradigms be? What will our society look like? What will our economy look like, right? So these things, I think, are going to be become commonplace. The idea of live in your heart, stretch the body, open the mind, and open the heart through yoga and things like this. These are might sound like I'm trying to convince you of something, but really I'm just saying, like, it's about happiness. Like, if you want to be happy, you deeply know, your heart is telling you, your soul is telling you that these are the methods for happiness. I'm not saying that if you're not ready for doing yoga, that's perfectly okay. Right now, what is your situation in life? And I put a video up about this on my YouTube channel recently, which is about truth. And that the truth is, how do you feel right now? That's what truth is. How do you feel right now? For me, my truth is enjoying work, doing yoga, meditation, having healthy relationships. For me, that's my truth right now, right? And my truth is not watching Fox News and CNN and fretting about unnecessary things. I know that the law of garbage in, garbage out, right? This is a fact. If you're influenced by garbage, you put yourself in situations where you're influenced by violent movies, fear-mongering news, relationship. You still have relationships with friends that just drain your energy, and you know in your heart, like, man, this person, I love them, but they're draining my energy, and they don't know that, right? When you're in a place of loving yourself and loving everyone, right, you have to consider yourself as a person too. Sometimes empaths might say, "Oh, I'm going to worry about others," but your cup must overflow with happiness and love before it goes out and floods to others. So make sure your cup is full. Make sure your cup is full. Yeah.
This is a really important idea and connects to what I was talking about earlier with respect to needing to be healthy oneself before being able to help others. And maybe a different way we could put it is, once we have achieved a certain kind of health, other fields of health open themselves up to us. So once I have achieved maximal happiness that I can have as an individual, then I'm going to want to focus on relationships, on spreading happiness and dissipating suffering globally, which means political orientation. I'm going to want to do all of these things. They're going to become apparent to me because I've taken care of what I can as an individual. And I still have more time and I still want to do more things. So that's the heart, you know, that's going to drive that. I had a little more I wanted to say, but I wonder if we should check and see if there are any questions we want to address, just because I'll have to get on in about 15.
Yeah, I found a strategy that works. I have the conversation up on my phone.
Okay.
There's no questions, just a few people who have dropped in to like the video and watching. So.
Okay, cool. I don't really remember what I was going to say anymore.
One thing I wanted to ask you is, can you explain how you see Charles Eisenstein's view of the future that our hearts know is true? I don't think I said that correctly, but like, what do you see in the future?
It's a difficult question. I've actually been processing a lot of grief, anger, and fear, I would say, these last weeks, and doubt that has come along with those emotions. So there are a lot of prophecies and discourses about this time in the spiritual community that basically say darkness is being released, but in the end, we are heading toward a brighter future. There are Native American prophecies about this. There are astrological prophecies. There are just general sightings of psychics. And as I've looked at the fires, and as I've paired them with the pandemic and the way that it's encouraging people to only relate to one another virtually and to navigate the world with this fear of our environment, I've begun to fear that the future will be increasingly restrictive and fear-based, that we will live more and more indoors, only relate to one another through technology. And this brings a sense of heartbreak for me because there are a number of things I always envisioned myself as having, including a wife, children, a professorship at a university. Now I'm wondering, will it be intelligent to have children? Will universities even exist? So over the past week, I've had a sensation of standing on shaky ground with respect to this brighter, more promised future. I do believe it's possible to see things both ways, but that's just how I've been feeling. And to what you were saying earlier, my general kind of dictum with myself is whatever I feel, I just feel it and I don't try to change it. And so these have been very bleak weeks for me. And I've just been sitting with those emotions and trusting that for some reason I need to feel them, right? There's the interpretation that I'm feeling them because they're logically correct and life actually is going to be that way. Or I'm feeling them because I need to process and let go of them in order to move into some other possibility. And the trick about living from our heart and being identified with spirit as opposed to the mind is we can't know which it is. We have to surrender. So that's what I've been going through with respect to these topics, but I wonder what you think.
Yeah, absolutely. So I had a meeting like 3 months ago with one of my meditation teachers, who said that, you know, Kyle, your soul is kind of like a Taoist soul. And I was like, okay, cool. So then I had to do some additional research as to what that is. And basically, I see that Taoism is like water, a river, and that flowing with nature. So a Taoist would flow with anything that is presented. And I think the nature of reality is yin yang. So everything's just kind of swinging back and forth between black and white, or anything. It's just a metaphor for that. Things in life just kind of flow, and you can either get attached to the thing that's going to be impermanent, or you can kind of sit there and play with these changes and be that which never changes, which i.e. I would say is your heart consciousness. Which is always there. You've always been it, even before you're born and after you die. But anyways, I would say that this with emotions is also very similar. So we have human emotions are part of those waves in the ocean, right? We have suffering, we have happiness, we gain weight, we lose weight, we no longer like the foods that we used to like, right? For example, for me, I had a pretty deep depression from like 16 to 18 years old. And then I had an incredible experience at college until, you know, I was 22, for example. And those are just like two stages of life. What was the thing that was the same? Was my inner consciousness, which I now see is also the outer, but that's another conversation. But basically my awareness of all of reality, whether it was me, doesn't matter. If it was other people, doesn't matter. If I was feeling depressed that day, that I was feeling successful that day, I began to see that it's more about flowing with all of these uncertainties. There's going to always be uncertainties with life. That's just, we can't predict the future at all because we have free will. I believe that we have free will. And with free will, we can choose either to be mired in all of the changes and get mad and get sad and angry and really happy, and then all of a sudden that, but really allowing those emotions to completely flow through you from your head to your feet, from, if it's from your gut, right, allowing it to flow up to out of your hands or out of your head or out of your feet. You begin to
like see the diagram behind you.
Yeah, just like this, right? Just kind of let it flow out, flow in. You know, we have the earth energy heading down, the sky energy heading up, your heart. The green here is connected to your hands. Okay, these are just things I experience in Qigong and meditation, things like this. But we don't have to hold on for very long to these emotions. These emotions are stuck into our bodies from our childhood, from past lives, perhaps, I don't know. But these are purely physical responses because we are mammals. So there's nothing, we don't need to judge ourselves for having fear. We don't need to judge ourselves for being super happy. We don't have to judge ourselves for judging ourselves. just let it, my meditation, another one of my meditation teachers says, just let it flow. Energy wants to move. Let the energy move, right? That's why I'm beginning to not just meditate, but also do Qigong and yoga. Mm-hmm. Move the body in fluid way, very, very fluid ways. Like move your hands, move your fingers, move your head, right? Stretch. It's just a beautiful thing. Yeah.
Nice. This reminds me of something else I would like to bring up, although I'm going to have to leave in a few minutes. But you were talking about not judging your emotions. And I do think we're in process of shifting this, even with the discourse of mental health. But even in the term mental health, there's the idea that the peak is happiness, right? This sort of permanent exalted state. And that if you're not feeling that way, something is wrong. And you and I have touched on this before, but this can bleed into the spiritual community. And we can see this in terms of its domination by things like whiteness and masculinity. For instance, as I was talking about earlier, a lot of Black people in the US at this moment feel incredible rage or despair at the state of society for them. And you know, a person who holds this subtle belief that happiness is good or happiness is right and that other emotions are aberrations from it would be drawn to the spiritual bypass, right? Oh, just let go of your anger. Just don't take it personally. And these are actually manifestations of personality traits, of characteristics that have to do with our identity that we don't see. That's what a blind spot is. And so the truth is that one is an enlightened being, even if one feels angry, sad, jealous, all of these emotions that we think of as negative. These pass through awareness regardless of anyone's quote unquote level of elevation or success along the path. So I just want to bring that into this discussion as we wind down, that I believe from a very deep spiritual perspective, we cannot blame anyone else for their emotional state or any other state in which they show up. It is quite literally who they are. And it is produced by their environment in the same way that happiness may have been produced in us. So this sort of awareness really allows things to flow and allows people to feel accepted and thereby to grow into more full personhood, whatever that may be on a case-by-case basis.
Yeah, absolutely. As you're saying that, I kind of realized that even the emotions that we view as negative are actually enlightened themselves, right? They're our teachers, and there are connections to who we are from our past, maybe continue in the future. And even if the emotions we perceive as negative really they carry those lessons with them. And then the other point I want to really emphasize here at the end is, even though we say that a lot about spirituality is working on yourself, but you want to work on yourself with others who are working with themselves. So finding sangha, community, finding a therapist, finding a teacher, you know, it could be anything. Maybe you're not vibing with either of us, which is completely okay, right? There's a million other great communities, great teachers, great therapists, great counselors, great even school teachers out there that you can become a part of. That's what's beautiful about online right now, is you can find like-minded people anywhere on the internet, anywhere in the world. So I encourage you to go seek out these communities, like-minded people, also seeking healing and seeking enlightenment and seeking truth.
Yeah, these are very good admonitions or encouragements for viewers. As we close, I want to suggest that we raise some kind of open-ended questions. And then maybe we can just do a little prayer together. So
would you like to lead that?
Sure, I'm happy to do that. So for some of the open-ended questions, what does it mean to be healthy in your heart versus your mind versus your body versus your spirit? What does it mean to be healthy as a collective? What does it mean to be healthy as a planet? Do you want to ask anything else, Kyle?
Yes. The thing that I think is our emotions. I would say, can I fully feel these emotions? Can I fully accept that these emotions are true because they are here for me right now? Can I fully feel these emotions?
What will become open for you if you fully feel your emotions?
Right. What will be at the end of that tunnel of that emotion? Right. Is beauty and
And as we draw to a close, I'm just going to close my eyes and put my hands in the prayer motion, and I am thinking of anyone who is afraid right now about the pandemic, either for their health or for their business or their social life. I'm thinking of anyone who is afraid because of the environment and the changes we're seeing. I'm thinking of anyone who feels anger or despair about race or the state of government in this country or other countries around the world. Do you want to bring into our sphere, Kyle, anyone else who might be suffering in this moment?
Yes, all the teenagers in the world who might be experiencing depression, existential crises, or just uncertainty and lack of motivation.
On that note, I'm also thinking of anyone who may be struggling with mental health, anyone who may have considered ending their life at this time. I'm thinking of anyone who may be getting increasingly agitated through social media. The alienation in which we are living is producing this state, is kind of amplifying this state. And I'm thinking of any animal who lives in fear right now too, as a result of the environmental changes. I'm thinking of any bird who's been displaced from its home, or a mammal who's had to flee a habitat. Do you want to bring anyone else into the sphere, Kyle?
I just wanted to add a little bit of a kind of a flow prayer, maintaining our awareness at our hearts and seeing that there's a source of this beautiful white light, and allowing that energy to flow inwards towards ourselves, and seeing that this beautiful energy is here to heal us, and then maintaining awareness at the heart center. Now seeing that energy flowing out towards all of those who we are in meditation and prayer for.
Beautiful. May our light and our intentions and our actions usher in a healthier world and bring all beings peace and happiness.
Amen. Namaste.
Amen. Namaste. Cool. Thanks for doing that with me, Kyle.
Yeah, thanks for leading that.
Yeah, it felt good.
All right. Well, Jackson, thanks for joining this conversation. Hopefully people who see this on YouTube enjoy it, can certainly subscribe to the Spiritual Download, like the videos, see previous ones. And Jackson, you want to talk about what your projects are up to right now?
Yeah, you can check out my channel as well. It's just Jackson Holzberg Buckley. I put out videos maybe a couple times a month, like Kyle. I offer some packages on my website. I can help you achieve greater awareness and easefulness in your life through identifying with characters in literature. I can help you with general life awareness in the form of tutoring. And Kyle and I are going to be introducing a joint project too, but if you want to visit my website to learn more about me, it's jacksonholzbergbuckley.com. So thank you everyone for tuning in.
All right. Have a good rest of your evening, everybody. Thanks for joining.